Hi friends, hello and welcome to episode 13 of my show, Editorial Compass. Friends, in this program I normally take you through the number of newspapers, mostly relevant editorials and at times even some interesting articles, just to give you an overview as to how India appears from the point of view of the press. So welcome to my show once again. Mitro, there appears to be no middle path in politics. Mostly you find journalists favoring a particular political party as if they have lost their own mind and so are dancing to the diktats of the political parties and are even forced at times to lie through their teeth. I therefore select a news item or an article that is well balanced. With that in mind, let me take you through the gist of an article titled Over and Above India's Election Rhetoric and Its Obfuscations, Balakot Strike Sent Pakistan a Major Strategic Message. This article is by Subir Bhaumik, who is an author and a former BBC correspondent. Political parties seeking to score brownie points in election season have trivialized the national security debate after the Indian Air Force or IAF strike at Balakot. Posters of Wing Commander Abhinandan Vartaman alongside top BJP leaders have made it clear the ruling BJP is keen to milk the maximum political mileage out of Balakot. BJP President Amit Shah and other party leaders have claimed casualty figures between 250 to 400, but the BJP's SS Ahluwalia has said the airstrike was only a warning and India was keen to avoid human casualties. Congress has sought to project the release of Jaish Chief Mohammad Azhar after the Kandahar hijack as a surrender, first blaming National Security Advisor Ajit Doval, then in IB, for carrying Azhar in a plane and then crediting him for opposing his release and describing the decision as political. Then when Rahul Gandhi described Jaish Chief as Masood Azhar Ji, BJP was quick to see in it evidence of his respect for terrorists. The quality of debate in a democracy depends on the awareness of the electorate and the leadership. So the frivolous claims and counterclaims on a key national security issue like this indicates the flip side of the dance of democracy. It is about time the post-Balakot discourse is rescued from ridiculous politicization, even if in a democracy such as ours, mindless shouting matches are not entirely unexpected. Three key points must be made over the Balakot strike and the one using special forces to avenge the terror attack on Uri. 1. Covert strikes to avenge terror attacks have happened in the past also, but were never owned up by India. This is the first time India is claiming the right of hot pursuit as a strategic option to fight terror, calling Pakistan's bluff through its repeated nuclear blackmail. The Modi government, for all its failures ranging from the demonetization to its lack of response to Hindutva vigilantism, must be credited for allowing our defense forces to work out viable retaliatory options, which surely surprised Pakistan and sent a message across the world that India too was tired of strategic restraint and major powers have to push Pakistan to avoid a military confrontation between nuclear armed neighbors. Here I, as the narrator, would also like to credit Modi government for resolving the Mexican standoff in Doklam. 2. The strikes across the border establish India's right of response to terror attacks. Batting and not just fielding, as Minister Rajvardhan Singh Rathore put it, if the US can invade Pakistan to avenge the Twin Tower bombings, India is well within its right to hit the Jaish camp at Balakot. 3. India has achieved a major diplomatic success in isolating Pakistan, where Iran, Afghanistan and Bangladesh have strongly backed India in attacking Pakistan as the prime source of terror in Asia, with Iran threatening strong retaliation for the suicide bombing on its Revolutionary Guards convoy, and Bangladesh refusing to accept the credentials of Pakistan's ambassador-designate to Dhaka, Saqlain Saida. It would be naive to imagine that Balakot airstrike was an election stunt designed to revive BJP's fortunes ahead of polls. The country's national security planners, in close coordination with the local executive, have during the last 4 years debated and planned possible responses to terror strike like Uri and Pulwama. That the IAF could launch such a strike within a fortnight of Pulwama meant that it had been tasked to prepare such a response. Now that brings us to the leadership question. Friends, leaders make a difference to the way a nation responds, with the exception of perhaps Israel. Indira Gandhi openly backed the Bengali guerrilla movement in 1971 and opted for the military offensive to liberate Bangladesh after asking army to prepare for the final push at least 5 months before the war in December. But Manmohan Singh from the same party decided to exercise restraint after the 26/11 terror strike on Mumbai. Similarly, Atal Bihari Vajpayee, on advice from NSA Brijesh Mishra, surrendered at Kandahar despite opposition by Home Minister Advani and others, including Ajit Doval, then Special Director of Operations of IB. Modi initially followed Vajpayee in making peace overtures to Pakistan, even most expectedly allowing ISI participation in the Pathankot terror strike inquiry. But following Uri, he rightly opted for a harder line. Both Vajpayee and Manmohan continued efforts to find a peaceful solution for Kashmir despite Kargil and 26/11. Modi may now, if re-elected, step up the ante in Balochistan, which I think is the need of the hour, with Iran now far more willing to bleed Pakistan. So friends, that's all I have for today. It was a short article. If you liked my show, kindly share it. Also, please subscribe our channel by pressing the red icon, and don't forget to press the bell so that you are notified each time we upload a video. And for now, goodbye and see you soon.